Today we're going to be taking a look at what almost 13 years of development has done for the Raspberry Pi. I have one of each generation of Pi, from the original Pi that was launched back in 2012, through to the Pi 5 that was released just over a year ago. We'll take a look at what has changed between each generation, and how their performance and power consumption has changed by running some tests on them. This is the original Raspberry Pi, which was launched in February 2012. This Pi has a Broadcom BCM2835 SoC, which features a single ARM core running at 700 MHz, along with a video core 4 GPU. It has 512 MB of DDR RAM. In terms of connectivity, it has 100 MB networking, two USB 2.0 ports, video output is 1080p through a full-size HDMI port, or analog video out through a composite video connector, and then audio output through a 3.5mm audio jack. It doesn't have any Wi-Fi or Bluetooth connectivity, but it does have some of the features that we still have on more recent models, like a DSI and CSI port, an SD card reader for the operating system, and GPIO pins, although it's only got 26 of them at this stage. Power is supplied through a micro USB port and is rated for 5 volts at 700 milliamps. It was priced at $35, which at the time was incredibly cheap for what was essentially a palm-sized computer. The Raspberry Pi 2 was launched 3 years later, in February 2015. This Pi looked quite a bit different to the original, and similar to the Pis that we know today. The Pi 2 has a significantly better processor than the original. The Broadcom BCM2836 SoC has 4 Cortex A7 cores running at 900 MHz, and it retained the same video core 4 GPU. RAM was also bumped up to 1 GB. It added another two USB 2.0 ports alongside the 100 MB Ethernet port. The composite video port disappeared, and the analog video output was moved into the audio jack. The GPIO pins were increased to 40 pins, which has followed the same pin layout since. This has really helped in maintaining compatibility with hats and accessories. The SD card reader was changed to a micro SD card reader, and the power circuitry was bumped up to 800 mA to accommodate the more powerful CPU. The Raspberry Pi 3 was launched just a year later, in February 2016. The Pi 3's new Broadcom BCM2837 SoC retained the same 4-core architecture, but these were changed to 64-bit Cortex A53 cores running at 1.2 GHz. RAM was kept at 1 GB, but was now DDR2. There was no change to the USB or Ethernet connectivity on the original Pi 3, but we did see Wi-Fi and Bluetooth added for the first time. Wi-Fi was single-band 2.4 GHz, and we had Bluetooth 4.1. This is actually the 3B Plus version, which was launched a little later. The main improvements over the original Pi 3 was a 0.2 GHz boost to the clock speed, and the upgrade to gigabit networking, with PoE or power over Ethernet support, and it also had dual band Wi-Fi. The power circuitry was again improved, still running at 5 volts, but now up to 1.34 amps, which is almost double the Pi 2. Next came the Pi 4 in June 2019. This Pi came out at one of the worst times for global manufacturing, and was notoriously difficult to get hold of due to the impact of COVID on the global supply chain. Quite ironically, this hard-to-get Pi is one of the ones that I've got the most of, mainly due to my water-cooled Pi cluster build. The Pi 4 has a Broadcom BCM2711 SoC with 4 Cortex A72 cores running at 1.5 GHz, so again a slight clock speed increase over the Pi 3, but still retaining 4 cores. It also includes a bump up to a video core 6 GPU. This was the first model to feature different RAM configurations. It was originally available in 1, 2 and 4 gig variants, all featuring LPDDR4 RAM. And then in March of 2020, an 8 gig variant was added to the lineup as well. This obviously resulted in a few different price points, but impressively they still managed to keep a $35 offering 7 years after the launch of the first Pi. It retained the same form factor as the Pi 3, but with the network and Ethernet port switched around. Notably, two of the USB ports were upgraded to USB 3.0. Networking was now gigabit Ethernet like the 3B Plus, Wi-Fi was dual band, and it had Bluetooth 5.0. They also changed the single full-size HDMI port into two micro HDMI ports. Most people I know don't like this change, and find it annoying to have to use adapters to work with common displays, and these micro HDMI ports are prone to breaking when they're used often. I think general hobbyists and makers would prefer this to still be a full-size HDMI port, but the Pis are often used in commercial display applications, so I guess that's why they've gone with this dual micro HDMI configuration. The power circuit was actually reduced on this model, from 1.34 down to 1.25 amps, and the port was changed to USB Type-C. Lastly, and most recently, we have the Pi 5, which was launched in October 2023. This Pi features a Broadcom BCM2712 SoC with 4 Cortex A76 cores running at a significantly faster 2.4 GHz. It's also got a Video Core 7 GPU running at 800 MHz, so quite a bump up in the CPU and GPU performance. It's offered in 4 RAM configurations, but the drop in a 1GB offering means that it's no longer available at the $35 price point. There's a fairly significant increase in price up to $50 for the base 2GB variant. Some other notable changes are the inclusion of a PCIe port, which enables I/O expansion. This is quite commonly used to add an NVMe SSD instead of the microSD card for the operating system. There's also a much improved power circuit to handle this addition, now stepping up to 5 volts and 5 amps, along with a power button for the first time. The change in power supply requirements to 5 volts and 5 amps is a bit annoying, as most power delivery capable supplies cap out at 2.5 or 3 amps at 5 volts. It would have been more universal to require a 9 volt 3 amp supply to meet the Pi's power requirements. I assume they steered away from this because the Pi circuitry runs at 5 volts and 3.3 volts, and they would have then needed to add another onboard DC to DC converter. This increases complexity, size, and potentially the cost. It also would have made it a bit less efficient, but this does mean that you most likely need to buy a USB-C power supply that has been purpose-built for the Pi 5. The Pi 5 is also the first Pi to have its own dedicated fan socket. So that's a summary of the hardware changes, now let's boot them up and take a look at their performance. To compare the performance between the Pis, I'm going to run the following test. I'm going to attempt to play back a 1080p YouTube video in the browser, although I expect we'll have problems with this up to the Pi 4. We'll then run a Sysbench CPU benchmark, which I'll do for both single core and multi-core. We'll then run a GL Mark II GPU benchmark, then test the storage speed using James Chambers' Pi benchmark script, and then we'll run an RPerf network speed test. Lastly, we'll look at power consumption, both at idle and with the CPU maxed out. We can use that information to determine the Pi's performance per watt. To keep things as consistent as possible, I'm going to be running the latest available version of Pi OS from Raspberry Pi Imager for each of the Pis. I was pleasantly surprised that you can still flash an OS image for the original Pi in their latest version of Imager. I'll be testing them all running on a 32GB SanDisk Ultra microSD card. I'll also be using an ice tower cooler on each to ensure they don't run anywhere near thermal throttling. I started with the original Pi, and its first boot and setup process was a lesson in patience. It took me the best part of 2 hours to get the first boot complete and the Pi updated and all the testing utilities installed, but I got there in the end. Even once set up, it takes about 8 minutes to boot to the desktop, and the CPU stays pegged at 100% for another 2 to 3 minutes before it drops down to about 20% at idle. The original Pi refused to open up the browser, so that's where my YouTube video playback test ended. The Pi 2 managed to open the browser and actually started playing back a 1080p video. This in itself was surprising, but the playback was terrible. It dropped pretty much all of the frames both in the window and at full screen. The Pi 3 played back video noticeably better than the Pi 2, but it's still quite a long way from being usable, and still dropped a lot of frames. The Pi 4 handled 1080p video playback reasonably well. It had some initial trouble, but it then settled down. Full screen's also a bit choppy, but it is also usable. The Pi 5 handled 1080p video playback well. It didn't have any significant issues both in the window and in full screen. Next was the Sysbench CPU benchmark. I ran 3 tests on each and averaged the scores, and I did this for both single core and multi-core. In single core, the Pi 1 managed a rather dismal score of 68. The Pi 2 got a bit more than double the score, but the real step up was with the Pi 3. This managed 18 times higher than the Pi 2. The Pi 4 and 5 each offered a good improvement on the previous generation. Similarly in multi-core, the Pi 3 scored over 18 times the score of the Pi 2, and the Pi 4 and 5 provided good improvements on the Pi 3 score. Comparing the combined multi-score core of the Pi 5 to what a single core on the Pi 1 can do, the Pi 5 is a little over 600 times faster. Next, I tried running a GL Mark II GPU benchmark on them. I used the GL Mark II ES2 WLAN version, which is designed for OpenGL ES so that the Pi 1 was supported. I was surprised that the Pi 1 was even able to run GL Mark II, but it did complete the benchmark, although the score wasn't impressive. These results really show how the Pi's GPU has improved in the last 2 generations. Prior to these tests, I'd never seen a GL Mark II score below 100, and the Pi 1, 2, and 3 all managed to fall short of triple digits. Next was the storage speed test using James Chambers' Pi benchmark script. The bus speed has increased over the years from 25 MHz on the Pi 1 to 100 MHz on the Pi 5, so I expect we'll see these reflected in the benchmark scores. The storage speed test results aren't as dramatic as the CPU or GPU results, but it does show a steady improvement between generations. The Pi 3 did a bit worse than the Pi 2, but this small difference is likely just due to variability between the tests. Next, I ran a network speed test on each. The Pi 1 didn't get close to the theoretical 100 megabits per second, but the Pi 2 does. The Pi 3B Plus, although having gigabit Ethernet, is limited by it running over USB 2.0, which has a theoretical maximum of 300 megabits per second, so it came quite close to that. Both the Pi 4 and 5 expectedly come close to the theoretical gigabit speeds. Lastly, I tested power consumption on each Pi at idle and under load. I used the same Pi 5 power adapter to test all of the Pis to keep things consistent. I just used a USB-C to micro USB adapter for the Pi 1, 2, and 3. The idle results were actually closer than I expected. The Pi 2 had the lowest idle power draw and the Pi 5 the highest, but all were within 1 or 2 watts of each other. At full load, you can see the increase in CPU power draw, with the Pi 5 drawing almost 3 times the Pi 1 and 2. Converted to performance per watt using the Sysbench results, we can again see how much better the Pi 4 and 5 are over the Pi 1 and 2. There's a clear improvement in the performance that each generation of Pi is able to get per watt of power, which is essentially its efficiency. Although the Pi 5 draws more power than the Pi 1 under full load, you're getting almost 200 times more power out of it per watt. I really enjoyed working through this video and seeing how much Pis have changed over the years, particularly in terms of performance. I still remember being amazed at the size and price of the original Pi when it came out, and it's great that they're still fully supported and can still be used for projects, albeit with less CPU intensive tasks. Let me know what you think has been the biggest improvement to the Pi over the years, and what you'd still like to see added to future models in the comment section below. I personally really like the addition of the PCIe port on the Pi 5, and I'd like to see 2.5GB networking and a DisplayPort or USB-C with DisplayPort added to a future generation of Pi. Thanks for watching. Please remember to like this video if you enjoyed it, and subscribe for more tech and electronics projects, tutorials, and reviews.